We are in the processional gallery that gives some idea of what it was like in the protests to march. You can also access oral histories of individuals who actually participated in the civil rights movement here in Birmingham, Alabama. And you also have a beautiful view of Kelly Ingram Park, where many of the protests took place. That view is to my right, and to my left, you have an opportunity to see the beautiful dome, which houses the rotunda, which is the entrance to the Birmingham Civil Rights Institute. It chronicles the history of the civil rights movement that took place here in Birmingham, Alabama, and throughout the state of Alabama, and also even today it continues to have a ripple impact, a positive impact on human relations, not only here in this country but around the world. There are many stories here. The Institute chronicles the movement and it focuses on what happened here in Birmingham, but it also gives some indication of the march from Selma to Montgomery and other things that happened here in Birmingham, Alabama. And through a renovation of this facility that took place approximately 4 years ago, we show the relationships between the civil rights movement and human rights movements around the world. And we want to learn from those experiences. And I think there are examples around the world today that are indications that people have learned how to protest nonviolently. If you think about Occupy Wall Street, you think about some of the things that have happened in the Middle East, that direct relationships between what happened here in Birmingham during the 50s and 60s. Reverend Shuttlesworth led the movement here and had been leading nonviolent protests against segregation here in Birmingham, Alabama, long before Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. came to this city. As a matter of fact, Reverend Shuttlesworth actually was the person who invited Dr. King to come here. Reverend Shuttlesworth, in my opinion, is a true American hero. And I'm so glad that his story, his powerful story, is now being told throughout this country.
We're in the archives at the Birmingham Civil Rights Institute, which is a place where people can come and do research on the movement. It includes an oral history collection. We've had an oral history project since 1994. And we have a small collection of historic artifacts, evidence of what it took to change Birmingham.
What is this piece here?
The piece we have here is a newsletter from the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights, which was the Birmingham Movement organization, started by Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth and some other leaders of the community in 1956.
What were some of the things he would have addressed in this newsletter?
It was 1961, so this was before the height of movement activity in Birmingham that we consider 1963. This was rather earlier in the movement, and they were looking at things that had happened in the history of their organization. They were talking about the bombing of Reverend Shuttlesworth's home twice. The Freedom Rides had happened by this time, just a couple months before this newsletter was published, so there's an article about the Freedom Rides in there. Now we're looking at something else from the Shuttlesworth papers. This is a statement put out by Reverend Shuttlesworth and the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights. And if you notice the date, this is September 30th of 1963. The bombing of 16th Street Baptist Church occurred on September 15th of that year. And earlier in the year, again, the height of Birmingham movement activity had occurred in the park and in the streets, and the young people had filled the jails, and the movement had really scored a victory here in Birmingham. The organization is wanting at this point to point out that Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth is the leader of the organization. At this point, he lived in Cincinnati, Ohio. He had moved there with his family in 1961. To take the pastorate of another church, and yet he was in Birmingham all the time. The memo is pointing out that he's a resident of the city, a voting resident of the city, maintains his residence here and his telephone, and is very much a citizen of Birmingham while he's not a resident. And I find that really interesting given the timing of the memo. It also points out, point number seven is that the Alabama Christian Movement invited Dr. Martin Luther King and SCLC to join them in their movement, claiming ownership of the Birmingham movement. This is a booklet, and I'm going to need to turn the pages here, that was donated to us by someone who had visited the Institute before and was at a yard sale here in Jefferson County and came across the booklet and thought it was so horrendous, and told the other side of the Civil Rights Movement story that we needed to have it. And that donor was absolutely correct. We're trying to gather materials that are evidence of the massive resistance to the Civil Rights Movement that took the form of newspapers, publications like this, even music. You know, we have 45 RPM records that were put out by the Klan and Klan-like organizations that are resisting the Civil Rights Movement. This purports to tell the true Selma story, and it discredits the movement.
What are some of the points made in this magazine?
That the participants in the movement were largely from outside of Alabama. That they were communists, that they were involved in orgies and drinking, that same old line that was used often to discredit people, especially the communism line. This was supposedly taken after a demonstration showing all the littering and evidence of drinking and smoking and no good that they said people were up to. The photographs, frankly, appear to be, you know, doctored versions of photographs that I have seen in some photograph files, actually, that were from the Alabama Bureau of Investigation at times, even. So. This particular publication was released in a similar version. It had a different cover on it, but the same contents inside. It had an image, a horrible image of Viola Liuzzo's body on it. She was murdered after the march from Selma to Montgomery. She was a white woman from Detroit, Michigan, who had children and a husband. She left them in Michigan, and she came down to volunteer for the movement. And on the last day of the march, after the rally in Montgomery, she was transporting a young African-American male back to Selma. And they were shot at by some Klansmen, one of whom was an FBI informant. And she was murdered. And the young man with her pretended to be dead. He survived it. At any rate, this publication was re-released with an image of Viola Liuzzo's body on the cover. And the children who survived her said that they received a copy of this in the mail at their home. The purpose of this and things like this were clearly to discredit the movement. And if this were seen by just respectable middle class people in the 1960s, black or white, they would have a very bad impression of what the movement participants were up to, what their motivations were, and what they were really doing. You know, it was all to discredit the movement.